This is the first of our webinars, which is aimed at a particular part of the world, because of course we're very conscious that one of the effects of the pandemic has been to make it impossible to have our usual in-person alumni events, including our annual, in some cases more than annual, trips to East Asia, where of course we have a significant number of alumni and friends, and I think it's fair to say an especially influential selection thereof. And I know that Marguerite and I greatly miss, for the moment, our trips to East Asia. And the pandemic intervened at just the moment when Yvonne was about to make her first trip as Exeter Development Director to East Asia. So this is kind of keeping that prospect warm until the lifting of the pandemic makes it possible for us to resume a normal service. So we thought it would be an idea to, we've been having a series of webinars sort of aimed at the world in general, many of them given by our fellows, some of them by alumni. We thought it would be an idea to have some events aimed at particular parts of the world, and this is our debut, East Asia. So the what we're going to do today, it's morning here in Oxford. I'm conscious that it's very much evening where you are, is to have as our main event, as it were, a talk from an Exeter fellow, Luciano Floridi, who's an expert in artificial intelligence, that's going to be speaking to us later on. But I'd like to begin with a sort of catch up from the college with some particular reference to our new library project. As far as the catch up goes, you will all have inflicted on you in the next few days a general sort of my Hillary term letter, as it were. An obvious theme is the latest twist and turn of the pandemic in the UK. As most of you know, I think the UK had a further lockdown suddenly imposed upon it in the early days of the new year. This led to a drastic alteration in what we were expecting in terms of academic operations during Hillary term. As I think you probably also know, we had the large majority of our students here in Michaelmas term, albeit operating under all sorts of social distancing restrictions. The majority of our students were not here in Hillary term, though a significant minority were, because of these new government regulations. But I'm happy to report that academic activity continued unabated. I've just finished a great series of rector's collections, a ritual that a number of you will have suffered in your time. And of course, performance and reality can be two different things, but I can tell you that this was a very academically upbeat series of rector's collections, as were the parallel graduate review sessions with our postgraduate students. A number of you have helped us with an appeal to our alumni to assist our students who are caught here, as it were, during the Easter vacation. In any event, we're expecting more students back from the 12th of April, just after Easter, and subject to the rolling out of the UK government's roadmap, we expect even more students back for Trinity term. And with the rolling out of the vaccination program here in the UK, obviously our hopes are very high for Michaelmas term. We've made an effort to avoid college business being solely concerned with the pandemic over the last 12 months, and I think we've made a reasonable success of that. We've certainly continued with our outreach program, and our ever more diverse admissions testify that we're making some progress there. Under the leadership of our domestic bursa, we're also pushing ahead with efforts aimed at environmental sustainability, with some particular projects dealing with our waste products and energy consumption, for example. But above all, I guess, we put non-pandemic efforts over the last 12 months into our library project. And with apologies to a group which I expect receives a great many presentations in their professional lives. I'd like to give you a little presentation, a series of slides on the library project before we get to Luciano's talk. So my ever reliable colleague, Amelia Cross, has mounted the slides for me. And this is a view which many of you will recognize of the Fellows Garden facade of the college library. Of course, it's a building that was constructed along with the chapel and the rector's lodgings of the design of Gilbert Scott as long ago as the late 1850s. And it's a splendid building. One of Gilbert Scott was a great architect, and architects believe this is one of his most original buildings. And it's a much loved building, of course, in the Exeter community. But I think it's fair to say that after 160 years, it's worn out, outside and in. It needs a thorough renovation and restoration in order to preserve the historic fabric, but also to adapt the library to the needs of modern students. And on these next couple of pages, we've got some photos which are designed to convince you that the library really does need a bit of an overhaul. With this in mind, and a key event here was the fact that when Cohen Quad was opened, the lower half of the annex was emptied when the archives and special collections were moved to Cohen Quad. Creating a great potential for a renovation, which, according to our plans, among other things, will increase the number of reader spaces. Many of you will have heard, as I did in the 1990s, a lot of talk about the death of the book and the death of the library and so on. Well, demand for libraries among Exeter students is still very strong indeed. And being able to add, as this project will allow us to do, something like 15 extra reader spaces is a major positive feature of the project. In May 2019, we appointed NEX, a London-based architects firm, in conjunction with conservation architects at Historic Building Advisors. And we've developed plans despite the pandemic and managed last month actually to put in our planning permission. Subject to governing body approval, we're anticipating a start to construction in June 2022 and to reopen the library after 12 months of temporary library provision, probably a marquee. We've grown to love marquees during the pandemic, to start the new library on its path for academic year 2023-2024. The projected cost of the library is about £10 million. Some people say, well, that seems a lot of money. Well, it's a library that's had very little invested in over 160 years, except for some rather drastic modernization efforts in the annex in the 1950s. And in any event, we've raised about £4.5 million already through philanthropic donations, and obviously we're hoping to raise a lot of the rest. The restoration project, as I was saying, will create a third more reader spaces. In marked contrast to the current library, it's going to be fully accessible, which of course is a key aspect of any modern restoration project. And it's going to be environmentally friendly in terms of its ventilation, lighting, heating, etc. Crucially, in addition to creating modern workspaces for students, it's also going to conserve the historic fabric, along with replacing the roof and other mundane but necessary considerations. The next few slides show you some images of what the new library will look like. This would be the remodeled area, which through the current entrance, which currently has what little we provide for our librarians by way of workspace. And as you can see, a much less cluttered environment is envisaged. We're going to be able to make the ground floor of the main part of the building much more usable by having a new entrance in the space between the library and the Bodleian, which you can see in the lower right-hand area, which Amelia is helpfully using the pointer for there, between the two buildings. And the next couple of slides show what that new entrance will look like inside. As I mentioned, a crucial part of the project is making the library accessible. So there will actually be a lift installed. There's no lift in the current building. And as the next slide shows, the external projection of that lift is going to be very modest indeed, in keeping with the historic nature of the library and its proximity to one of the great buildings of Oxford, and for that matter of the UK as a whole, the Bodleian itself. The annex is going to be completely redone. You get an image on the left here of what the annex looks like at the moment, and indeed that's a photo on a good day, I would say. On the right-hand side is an image of what it will look like from below when the remodeling is done, a totally different aspect to it. And the next slide gives you another view, not just of the current annex, but also on the right-hand side of what it will look like from below. You can see there's a mezzanine above, and the next slide shows the what that mezzanine will look like from the mezzanine level itself. Lots of space for books. This is by no means a bookless library, quite the opposite. And as you can see, it's actually, as far as the annex is concerned, making the historic features of the building much more obvious than they are at the moment. And then finally, some floor plans to give you an idea of what the annex in particular looks like from a diagrammatic point of view. And last, an inspirational quote from our alumnus, Philip Pullman, about how the library inspired him in 1965. We want the library to continue to inspire people, but in a much more modern as well as a restored historic environment than is available at the moment. So I'll pause there. Any questions or comments anybody would like to make about the library project, or for that matter, questions or comments about the college as a whole at the moment. There's a, as many of you will know from Microsoft Teams, there's a hands feature in your the upper right-hand toolbar, which you can click on if you want to attract attention. Anybody want to have a go?
What's the next milestone in the library coming up?
What's the next milestone? Yeah. Well, a governing body will consider in April and May committing itself to the construction. So that will be the next milestone. All being well with that, and we've carried out some elaborate consultations within the college community. We had a so-called town hall event in November, which a number of students attended as well, especially the student leaders. Then we would go on to a procurement exercise straight away, really, which would be necessary, as you can imagine, to get the actual construction going, say 14 months later. Mike?
A couple of questions. How heavily used is the library? In my day, it was quite thinly used. Has that changed down the years? Or?
Yes, you shocked me with that, Mike. no, it's
we were a lot lower in the Norrington terms, of course.
Well, I cast no aspersions on earlier generations of students, but no, it is heavily used, especially at exam times, but not just then. And indeed, there needs to be a certain amount of policing of the practice beloved by students in all universities of trying to sort of make spaces their own for very long periods of time. And one of the features of the new electronic control system is to indicate just how long somebody's been there. No, it is in fact heavily used, and one of the reasons the students are enthusiastic about the project, even though they realize this will be a year's disruption, is because the current number of reader spaces, even supplemented by the Learning Commons in Cohen Quad, which is very popular too, is simply inadequate.
So second question on the funding side, I seem to remember discussions in the past where the Tolkien family were sort of being approached or targeted for the library. Is that still the case? Or?
Yes, we're having another go at the Tolkien Foundation, the sort of institutionalization of the Tolkien family. Their trust it has a very broad remit, however, which is, you know, a betterment of the whole world. So we are trying them. We're also applying to other trusts like the Wolfson Trust, which has contributed, you know, not huge amounts, but useful amounts to a whole range of Oxford projects, including Cohen Quad itself. So we're in addition to appealing to our alumni, you'll be pleased to know, Mike, that we're not neglecting these various potential institutional donors.
Yeah, okay. I would just add that we have a proposal in with the Tolkien Trust at the moment. So yeah. Just waiting to find out what the feedback is on that and whether we're accepted to go into the second stage. It's much more formal now than it was in the past. There's more of a kind of gatekeeper process to be able to get through there. But yes, we're absolutely talking to them and discussing. And we're hopeful that they will want to have some involvement with the project.
And of course, it's, you know, as a quote from Philip Pullman implies, it's not simply Tolkien, important a figure as he is. There's the whole literary tradition. And of course, we're also trying to appeal to people across the disciplinary spectrum, since, you know, one of the proud features of Exeter is that for a college of average size, we have more than an average spread of subjects that we enroll undergraduates in, as well as graduate students. Anything else for the moment? Okay, well, obviously you'll hear more from us about that, but you've been very patient in listening to my presentation. I thank you for that. Let's move on then to the main act. I've been the straight man. My colleague Luciano is going to provide us with the main feature of what for you is this evening's event. Exeter College these days has significant strength in this currently and in the future very important field of artificial intelligence. We're in the process of, the university is in the process of, at the moment, of hiring a new professor of artificial intelligence, the DeepMind chair of AI, which is to be attached to Exeter College. And one of the reasons we succeeded in that bid is that no fewer than four of our fellows have significant academic strengths in AI. And one of them is this evening's speaker, Professor Luciano Floridi. Luciano is professor of philosophy of the philosophy and ethics of information at Oxford, where he's director of the Digital Ethics Lab at the Oxford Internet Institute. He's a world-renowned expert on digital ethics, the ethics of artificial intelligence, the philosophy of information, and the philosophy of technology. He's published more than 300 works in a variety of languages. And he's also deeply engaged with policy initiatives on the socio-ethical value and implications of digital technologies and their applications. And he collaborates closely on these topics with many governments and companies worldwide. So it's my pleasure to hand over now to Luciano to give us his talk, and we'll have Q&A after the talk on AI developments and ethical challenges. Over to you, Luciano.
Thank you, and thank you everybody for being here. I normally suggest to my students to make sure that the expectations are very low. That is a key to any success. So I'm afraid that Rector has not managed very well to follow that particular strategy. So I hope you will not be disappointed. The talk has some in my mind at least a couple of goals. One is to make me feel good, because I don't do much for the college. So when I was asked by Yvonne whether I could help, I said, yes, this is a great thing. I can actually be part of the team, you know, as a philosopher, and I'm also not a tutor. You feel like you're taking a lot, you're not giving much back. So I thought, yes, that's a good thing. The other goal is really to put on the table, as you were, a few topics for the Q&A. So I think that the more interesting part will be the second, when we can have a discussion. With just a premise, which is some of the things I'm going to present are or may be perceived as less than orthodox. You will see when and how in the description of AI in particular, not exactly what we get from the newspapers. I'm also aware that some of you might be working with this kind of stuff on a daily basis. To those, apologies, because I will be as shallow as I can possibly try to be. Now, with a bit of support from the technology, I will, I'm afraid, share the classic PowerPoint, which I tried to make a bit less heavy going, so more pictures than words over there. And at this point, if I'm correct, you should be able to see the PowerPoint being projected. Perfect. You can tell is already there the distinction between the developments and the challenges. So the first half of the talk will be on why do we have this AI so successful around us. Second half, what challenges are generated by this great success. And since we do not have that much time, let me move through the slides rather quickly. For particular points that will tackle why AI has been such a success now, and I will present that as a divorce between agency and intelligence. I give away the point immediately, and that's the unorthodox point. AI is successful precisely because we have given up trying to make something intelligent. We have not followed any further the cognitive approach to AI. We decided to do good engineering and therefore problem solving. And it doesn't matter whether the solution is or is not intelligent. What does matter is that it delivers what it's supposed to deliver. Why that generates some ethical issues, that divorce between agency and intelligence, the sort of challenges they are facing, therefore, and the governance that is required to tackle the challenges generated by this divorce. That's the straight story. Let's start from the divorce. One way of being the whole digital revolution in general, what's happening under our eyes, is, and there are many ways, so a simple one, is a cut and paste. You take all you, say, have learned when you were undergraduates here, or if you like, so modern stage in our culture, and some of the things there that we have inherited, I'll tell you more in terms of examples, were blocks. We assumed they were blocks. We never thought they could be unglued. And yet, that's exactly the cut produced by digital technology. And some of the things we thought they were completely independent. They had nothing to do with each other. And digital technologies glued them together in new blocks. So imagine this as I said, cut and paste of, to be more philosophical, modernity, what we have inherited from the past century. Examples, here is a gluing moment. You no longer talk about offline, online. What you talk about is on life. It's a continuum between being connected. There is no point in thinking, oh, do we or do we not go online anymore? That's particularly true about our students, but certainly also our experience. Just to remind you, I mean, we constantly track by mobile phones, geo-tagging and so on. There is no real sense in asking the question, are you online, are you offline anymore? I normally say that if you ask that question, you are from the 90s. another way of gluing together things in this infosphere, analog and digital. It doesn't make any more sense to say something is analog or digital. I mean, at least my experience in my kitchen, you know, you're cooking something, you might be downloading, meanwhile, streaming some music, you might be reading the recipe will come back on your mobile phone, etc. In fact, actually, I have an old iPad that I use only for streaming music. It's so old, you can't do anything else. But we have also unglued things, presence and location. Remember that that is the whole experience of humanity since day one. And for those of you who read classics, when the Greek gods had to intervene in the battle under the walls of Troy, they had to get there. They cannot do that at a distance. They have no robots on Mars, okay? They have to move. That's because presence and location have been in human history constantly two sides of the same coin. Until yesterday. Today, completely unglued. So when you ask what's happening to a branch of a bank and it's being closed down, it's because you don't need to go to the bank anymore. And that's presence and location completely separated. I was consulting with a big banking sort of company here in the UK. And the first question I ask is, do you give people coffee when they come to your bank? No, we don't. Well, that's one way of gluing together presence and location again. That's why coffee shops are all over the place in a bookstore. It's not to make a bit of money. It's to make sure that people go there, presence and location, where you are physically, where you interact, you know, at a distance. And then they even buy a book. Low intermediate reality, completely unglued. There is a map of Westphalia, 1648. From that year onwards, we glued together the law and territoriality to simplify my place, my rules, your rules. Well, not if in cyberspace, and I can tell you much more about, say, the right to be forgotten, Google, etc. You cannot, like France, ask during the debate at the European Court of Justice, google.com to remove links to information that was supposed to be delinked by Google, because of course Google can remove those links from the French version of Google, but on doodle.com does whatever he wants. The reply, but then it doesn't make any difference. You're right, that's why law and territoriality now have been separated and we're not quite sure what to do next. This long premise is to say that this cut and paste, and now you've got a sense, now Bitcoin, many more things that can be discussed under this agenda. Well, what's happening to AI? Is it a gluing moment? You know, are we putting things together or are we actually separating? The mainstream story about AI is that we are actually pasting together two things. Natural biological intelligence on one hand and engineering artifacts on the other. That's the special moment. What I'd like to convince you to think in terms of is actually an ungluing moment. And that is as radical and as transformative as the alternative, but generates completely different issues. What you see in the background actually is a warehouse UK. Those boxes are robots and they fish stuff from there. It's not a warehouse for any human being in the universe. The difference, you build the whole environment around the capacities of the robot, not the other way around. And that is part of the 5 points I'm going to illustrate in terms of why this is a divorce. For agency to be successful at zero intelligence, you need to change the environment so that the agency in the environment succeeds without being intelligent at all. More on this as we move on. Of course, by AI, we mean a lot of things. And these are the 5 points I'd like to illustrate. These are just one of the many, many maps. Natural language processing, normally machine learning, that's the main AI, if you don't specify anything else. Could be robotics. It could be the little bot that chats to you. It could be the interaction you have with something to book a table on a restaurant. So don't get me wrong. I mean, there are many paradigms and so on. But what has happened to us is that we have moved from logic to statistics. That's the first wave. No, I used to be a mathematical logician. When I used to teach this stuff to undergraduates, basically it was all mathematical logic made fancy, prologue and so on. We used to teach the statistical version as proof of concept. Yes, you could do this, you know, network stuff, etc., but we don't have the resources, it's impossible. So most of the algorithms we have today to do DeepMind kind of stuff, as you know, come from the 60s. I mean, they're not entirely new. It's just that some of the amazing things that we can do are due to the processing power and the enormous amount of data we have. So today we have moved from deduction to association. That move, which is the first point that I want to highlight, means something like this. I told you that the recipe will come back. This is the old way of doing programming. You have the ingredients, you want to cook some pasta, and you have the recipe, traditional cooking, and you get the pasta. That's the way you should normally do it. That's actually, in particular, is a carbonara. If you compare this to machine learning, to AI today, the strange thing is that you give to the machine the ingredients and the pasta, and the machine learns the recipe. That is the change. Now, in this particular sort of picture, that means showing, for example, to a machine, gazillions of pictures of a cat, the ingredients, teaching to the machine that, look, this is a cat, it's a cat. No, keep going, and it's another cat from a different angle, with a different color, a different light, or has only three legs, doesn't have a tail, but is still a cat. And at some point, the machine miraculously, quote unquote, will say that it's a cat, no matter what kind of picture you show to the machine that is actually a cat. In other words, has learned how to cook, has learned how to recognize cats independently of any cat in the world that, you know, will be so weird, so strange, etc. Now, this particular way of thinking, if you like, can get even a little bit more weird. The computer scientists in the group will forgive me, when you actually show them only cats. You don't even, no, you just show them data, and the machine is able to abstract from the data a pattern that is of interest to us. In other words, is able to extract both the data and the recipe behind the carbonara. Example, many years ago, work with Tesco. Tesco launches this machine learning on their data. They have no idea what it's going to come up with. Learning. At some point, discover an interesting pattern. Forgive me for the Italian sort of motive behind all this. They discovered, this is a real example, they discovered that on Friday night, people tend to buy pizza with red Italian wine. They had no idea why. It's not beer, and it's not white Italian wine, and it's not any red Italian. It's pizza and red Italian wine. Whatever the reason, they couldn't care less. They are not there for science, they are there for business. And so they reshuffled the whole internal market space, putting pizza next to Italian red wine. And it worked. Now, with that little introduction in place, that's the new AI we are dealing with. Why it is so successful? Well, because as I told you at the beginning, we are transforming the world around the capacities of these machines. We're not unleashing these machines in the world and saying, oh, can you build me a car? But actually, we build an environment like the one you have here in the background. Look at the top left, where there's a human being who's clearly not in the right environment. The environment is for robots. It's called an envelope in engineering. Mechanical engineers called successful 3D space, the envelope of the robot. So what we are doing is enveloping the world around these machines. Lower cost, more computation, immensely more, staggering more. Data, I'll show you in a moment, that something interesting that we have generated ourselves. Better machine learning, I'll just show you, better algorithms, more internal things, that's where we are all the time, and more on life. We have moved there, not the other way around. Things about just how much you do in terms of banking that is constantly digital, constantly on life. That means that those machines are increasingly successful because we are scuba diving, they are the fish. We're not supposed to be there, of course, no, we don't do analog stuff here and there, but the real sort of natives are the algorithms in a digital world. Now, with this picture in mind, normally people look at the right-hand side. Say, oh, amazing, there was so much, gazillions of data, that's extraordinary. But what I like you to, and then you find so many pictures of these, and they're constantly updated. I care much less about the right as opposed to the left. If you look at the bottom left, it all started yesterday. This is all the data we have on this planet, okay? includes Shakespeare, includes cows on the walls, not with a piece of chalk millennia ago. And yet, if you quantitatively, not of course qualitatively, but quantitatively generated in the past 15, 20 years, all on our shoulders. This generates a lot of other problems, not for today, but all that stuff is aging together. It's a tsunami. Think about our baby boom and pension kind of mentality. This is all aging together. It means that at some point we will have challenges technological or moving archives, outdated technology and so on. It's getting quite staggering. So this is also why the sea of data is where the fish of the algorithms are happily not swimming. You swim in that kind of sea, and of course, the success is guaranteed. The third point is a bit more complicated. I'll show you quickly this picture. But one trick that we have learned a long time ago is to transform difficult tasks into complex tasks. So there must be a philosopher, but no, it's quite straightforward. Put on the x-axis computational resources, again, for the more mathematically trained people in the group, forgive me. This is actual complex theory, as you learn it in computational theory. How much does it take to solve a problem? And usually we speak in terms of time and space. Time is steps in a computation, space is memory. So how much memory and how much not steps in a computation does it take to solve that problem? And you can put problems in different categories. So computational resources make from simple, zero, to complex, one. And on the y-axis, put things in terms of easy, what skills are required, to difficult, one. Now, turn the light on. A baby can do that. In fact, annoyingly so. I'm sure you have that experience. So the little kid, stop, Peter, don't do that. It's simple. It doesn't take much. Two steps, one and two, one and two. And it's elementary in terms of skills. A baby can do it. Now, look at tie one shoes. I still remember when my mom taught me that. It's still simple, just a few maneuvers. How many steps does it take? Maybe 5, 10? But it's more difficult than turning on the light. You learn that much, much later in life. Bottom right, washing the dishes. The algorithm is slightly more complicated. Take the dish, soap, water, dry, take another dish, soap, dry, etc. As my wife says, even a philosopher can do that, properly trained. It's easy. Several steps, and in fact, the steps are longer, the more dishes there are, but it's elementary. Top right, ironing a shirt. That is more complex and more difficult than turning the light on or dishwashing. All should be elementary, okay? So what is happening here is that we are transforming difficult into complex. AI eats complexity for breakfast, cannot do difficulty. So when you hear from this picture, the boss of Adidas, or might have been Nike, but I think it was Adidas, saying, if you find in a box a pair of shoes with the laces properly put there, it has been a human being. We don't have a robot that can do that because it's difficult. But if you want to have shoes that actually are computationally bottom right, then you have to change the shoes completely. Forget about laces, because those are not something that AI can handle easily. So you have to change the shoe completely. Now, if this example seems to be a little bit too fancy, here is an ironing robot. This is not the future. It's been developed in Madrid a couple of years ago and is tall, 1.8, requires a whole room. You should be able to hear maybe a little bit of noise. I tried to not make it sound like anything. So hopefully you just, I hope you just see it. And it does iron the shirt. The trouble is that in order to iron the shirt, you have to put the shirt there, have a whole room for that shirt, remove the shirt when it's done. Amazingly, from an engineering perspective, but remember what I told you? One way we are putting together things, or we want to separate them. This is an attempt to transform robots into us. It will be like having driverless cars, not transformed, but with the robot that goes in and drives like us, not the future. The future is this. This does exactly the same job, is as big as a dishwasher, and that's how it works. You put a shirt inside, comes out fully ironed. Now, the idea, you can tell behind this, is that you have transformed the world into something that the machine can do. You haven't put a machine in a world that cannot handle. Now, unless some people understand this, you can see why I would like to invest in this company, but not in the other one. This has a future. Oh, it's $3,000, by the way, if you want to buy Yvonne, this is the moment when we say we are not being sponsored by any of these companies. You know? Point number four, we move rules. Rules are fundamental. If you play any game, some rules are constitutive, some rules are regulative. For example, chess. No rules, no game. There's nothing that you can do that looks like chess, but not quite. Football. You start kicking the ball, and then you start saying, no, that's out. No, let's regulate. So there is an activity first that gets constrained by rules. Rules are regulative, and there are activities that are made by the rules. So all board games are such that the rules are constitutive. They made the game possible. The other games, tennis, football, any activity where you bump into things, but they are just regulative. You can still play tennis, you just or pretend. I still remember that a couple of bottles would be, the poles of the where you could play football, and that was a goal. So why this is crucial? Because AI loves constitutive and doesn't quite do regulative. Once you learn this, you know why DeepMind keeps winning anything at board games. A board game enables to do this. A board game has rules that create the game. You dominate the rules, you generate all the data you need. Football doesn't work that way. You don't have rules that generate the game. You got something first, which then gets constrained by the rules. So here I put to you very quickly three kinds of data as we move forward. Historical data, medicine, brain cancer. We don't know the rules of brain cancer. The physical and biological medical laws that we have in terms of understanding brain cancer, and actually the real example, Microsoft Research, Microsoft Lab in Cambridge, are things that we come up afterwards. There's something going on, like football, and then we regulate, so to speak. You always need historical data. Hybrid data, we skip them. If you want to know more about this, is what GANs are very good for in cybersecurity. You put two computers playing against each other, and one tries to beat the other. And as you play that, you have historical data on one side, and the other computer generates its own data. So they are a bit hybrid as well. Synthetic data are the data that you can generate by having rules that make the game. So in chess, you give the rules to the computer. The computer now is so powerful that plays against itself for about a day and becomes a chess master. Zero historical data. So what you heard in the past, oh yeah, of course he has all the libraries and all the games ever played, no longer, because now it generates its own data. Any data? Because for example, there's no privacy. If the computer generates all the data, does not need to ask permission to people, so to use the data that it has generated itself. More about this if you like, but that's the number five. And this is a bit, a quick synthesis of why we have the AI successful that we are enjoying in front of us these days. The five points that I quickly summarize. Because of this, and because of this divorce, and why this divorce is so successful, we have plenty of ethical problems. This is a quick picture that summarizes, if you like, the main challenges. And I put them in green, red, and amber, where the more interesting part, perhaps, is the amber. The green is what AI can do for us, or the opportunities. And you can read them there. But enabling, enhancing, increasing, cultivating, it's good stuff. I mean, it really helps humanity to do a better job. The counterpart is devaluing, removing, reducing, eroding, what we do, our responsibilities, our abilities to control, etc. But the amber is perhaps at the moment the highest risk we have. All the things that we're not doing because we're not quite sure. Opportunity cost for the economists in the group. That, for example, the NHS in the medical sector, their cost is staggering. The things that we can do today with machine learning that we're not doing, think, for example, in terms of the pandemic, what we could have done had we been able to put the right rules and the right ethics and the right legislation around the use of personal data would have been amazing. We didn't do that, and I can tell you much more. I was involved with the government in launching the failed app for coronavirus, and one of the main obstacles was the inability to step into the unknown without running risks of legal and ethical kind. And therefore, better safe than sorry, we don't do it. The costs are enormous. Now, this picture here has led to, and again, superficial, to a number of declarations, principles. By now, there are more than 120 of these declarations, because of course, every company now needs one, every government needs to show that, says something about this and that. In this picture, I'd like to call your attention to one in particular, where we, the OECD, by the time you get to the OECD sort of framework, you know that there is no need for anyone else to cook their own particular rules in terms of what is good AI, the principles. This table is a bit of a summary in terms of beneficence, non-maleficence, autonomy, justice, and explicability, or what you would expect from a good AI doing a good job for humanity and the environment. Anything passing that becomes just a regurgitation of things already done by other people. Look at a couple of missing dots here in IEEE, but above all in the Beijing AI principles. Pretty good. I mean, very close to what we have in Europe, with one exception. Not so much emphasis on autonomy, for obvious reasons of political kind that the director said we were not going to cover today, for obvious reasons as well. In this picture, and we're coming to the sort of second half, but I'm aware that we don't have much time, so forgive me for the rush. What are the challenges? I grouped them because I had 5 points in terms of development. I thought by in terms of some elegance, 5 points here as well in terms of challenges. And it's a big umbrella. I mean, you can see a lot of stuff going under each of these enormous containers. We need to make sure that AI works against wrongdoing. This is, covers, for example, illegal use. And we did a piece of research here in Oxford on how people are using illegally AI. The imagination of humanity is staggering. In this particular case, for example, just one case, bias, vulnerability. If one thing has been done by digital technology at large, has made vulnerability a very democratic problem. Everybody is. In fact, more so the rich people, the powerful people. So nobody cares about your bank profile if you're poor and you haven't got a penny. But the interest in having someone rich sharing the details about their bank accounts is huge. So the challenge here to make sure that the wrongdoing is not there is vulnerability at large. They have to support our decision control, not the other way around. Here, for example, just to illustrate with a concrete case, the level of complexity we are going to face in, for example, in urban is staggering. One of the places where machine learning in particular and large data sets, so-called big data, are increasingly useful is handling smart cities, twin cities, etc. And some of you might actually be involved with concrete example in this case. Those data are quite uncontroversial, but they are pre-pandemic, so we shall see. There's a lot of talk about going and leaving small, beautiful villages in Tuscany and work from there. I'm not sure, but the urban population is moving in increasingly large urban environment, the complexity of which is going to require the best technologies we have. Human responsibility, in this case too, we better have this powerful technology on our side. Classic example here is climate change. We just completed a very large study, potentially, but this stays in this room, the best study available at the moment in the world on the impact of AI on climate change. We did this in collaboration with the Vodafone Institute. The news are good, but not excellent. Maybe more if you like, but we need to remind everybody, not in this room, but outside, that of the a very silly point, AI consumes a hell of a lot of electricity. And therefore, while saving the world, you're also harming the world. I call that the green gambit, the digital gambit. So you sacrifice something to win the game, but the sacrifice is real. More on this if you like, but you heard about Bitcoin consuming more than New Zealand in terms of electricity, et cetera, et cetera. So it's a serious business. Four, it should make us more human. Here, the challenges with, for example, and again, just an illustration, autonomy. I already showed you this picture before. The erosion of autonomy, think in terms of advertisement, recommender systems, is constant, especially for young minds. Now, I see quite a bit of white hair here. We were not born with this digital technology already in place. If you're born today and you fast forward 18 years of constant bombardment, gentle nudging all the time, in terms of where to go for a meal, what to watch on TV, what music to listen, what book to read, what university to go to, what job to take, again and again and again and again. That is a risk. And finally, it has to work for humanity. I'll show you here a couple of pictures. We're getting to the end of my presentation. Work will get more and more polarized, and there will be more DIY in terms of who does what. But all the news on the around speaking about the jobs being destroyed, the elimination of jobs in the future, etc. I find that really bad journalism. Largely, I'll show you why. So if our student in my department were to provide this kind of analysis, they wouldn't pass their master degree. These are the major, and I hope no one is working for any of them over here, but there's everybody, Bank of England, OECD, Forrester, PwC, McKinsey. Bottom is number of years it will take before the tens of millions of jobs on the y-axis will be destroyed by automation. Now, I don't know if you can see that, but those are tens of millions of jobs, 10, 20, all the way up to 30. Look at the Bank of England, the most extreme. Prediction that by 2036, 30 million jobs will be destroyed in the US job market. Now, that was produced a few years ago. Now, anyone who can predict 20 years ahead what the world will be like has a crystal ball, a secret crystal ball, because it's virtually impossible. Let me remind you that this story started, unfortunately, from Oxford, a very important paper, which, if you read, has been carefully phrased. That paper, a long time ago, not picked up by The Economist, and has generated all this industry, says something fundamental in the introduction. Many people don't read anymore, of course, but it says the following predictions will be made assuming that legislation, for example, makes no difference to the job market. You heard correctly, but I repeat it just in case, because it's that silly. The following prediction will be made assuming that legislation makes no difference to the job market. Because, of course, if you start taking legislation into account, you predict. Because tomorrow we could pass a law saying any cab has to have two drivers on board, full stop. And that's the end of replacing cab drivers with driverless cars. With that kind of idea, it's like predicting, doing a weather forecast, assuming that the wind doesn't make any difference. Much, much easier and also useless. The mistake is to assume that work is a pie. If there's more work done by robots or autonomous agents or some AI, there's less for us. As we know, 101 economics, not true, it's not a pie. There's an endless amount of work, The real thing is the threshold of what is economically viable. It may not be worth doing it, but certainly there is an endless amount of it. Now, just think about all the chores on Sunday at home. You draw a line because now you run out of time, energy, money, whatever, but not because there isn't more to be done. And that is exactly where digital technology makes a difference. It moves the threshold of what is economically viable in terms of job market. So the real thing is, for example, this. This is the most recent analysis provided by the American Trucking Association report, and tells you where the job market is in terms of drivers. Drivers, if you see bottom right, are in huge demand. The myth of the driverless truck, the driverless car, has generated that kind of scissor sort of model of potential shortfall. We are already missing in the United States job market, not tens, but hundreds of thousands of positions. Now, I remind my students, and not people from Exeter, my students at the OII, that it's a well-paid job. So if you fail, in any case, being an academic, some of my students would like to be an assistant or associate professor. Well, a truck driver earns just about like an associate professor in a sort of mid-ranked university in the United States, anything between $60,000 and $80,000 a year. So it's a decent job, and just we don't have enough people. Why? Partly because the story was they're not needed anymore. This is the real problem. This is an old picture. If you like, if you look, it's 2018, but I put that for historical reasons because people then switch to the opposite view. Oh, look, Lloyd Banking cutting 6,240 jobs and then creating on the same day 8,240, 2,000 more. It's a wonderful life. It is not, because the people hired are not the same people sent home. That is the trouble. Of those 8,240, a very small percentage will be represented by the 6,240 that unfortunately are no longer able to do the jobs that are required. As we move across the digital revolution, is the social pressure and the social problem, the welfare, et cetera, that will be the real challenge. Now, in this case, we will have other interfaces. Some interfaces have been removed. If you look on the left-hand side, the gentleman there had a job because there was a law requiring a driving license to use an engine. So you had to have someone licensed to use that elevator. Remove the law, boom, the job disappeared on the day. The lady is an interface between a GPS and a car. That job might actually go, depending on whether we are good at this or not. And the gentleman there, we all have had that experience. That is the most extraordinary of all the pictures here. So we have robots on Mars, but there's no car on this planet that does not require a human being to pick up the thing, stick it in, and put it back. That is bad design, as you can possibly imagine. And we're doing the same with electric cars. We're just designing electric cars that require a human interface to put the electricity in and out. I've seen some designs by I work a lot with Audi, private cars and so on. And they are thinking about this. And I said, look, if one point stays on this day, say, please make sure that the most amazing interface in the world, our human brain, the universe has taken millions of years to create this amazing engine. Don't use it to recharge a car. Just make sure that there's some automatic system that works for us. The lady there at the counter has also been eliminated. How much DIY do we do now? We are the one who scans the beans, not some artificial intelligence for us. But there will be other interfaces where other jobs will appear. So to conclude, what can we do about this? And this is really the end of this little talk. We need more guidance. Where we want to go, as opposed to play tactical adaptation, some strategy. The governance of here becomes the real challenge today, especially for people in positions that make a difference. I hear a lot, Brussels, London, Berlin, the real challenge, technological innovation is the challenge. It is not. As we know, big companies buy technological innovation by the bucket. Now, just look at what Apple has been buying in the last 2 or 3 years, or startups, more companies, and so on. It's what we do with this that is becoming a real headache. Innovation is crucial, of course, but the real sort of super challenge is the governance of the digital, not digital innovation. And by the way, that picture is not like the most recent magazine, but it's actually Plato. It's Plato who describes the politician, the person who governs, the governor of the ship, as the Kubernetes, as you remember, possibly. The Kubernetes from which cybernetic is the governor of the ship, which knows the winds and the sea, knows where he wants to go, the direction, and navigates maybe left and right, sometimes has to go back, sometimes forward, in order to get there. That is the kind of governance that we need. Now, for that governance, we need a project and a map, a sense of what we want to do when we grow up, not just emergency, but also strategy. And that's what I want to close with. That's the penultimate slide. In different contexts, not for today, and it's going to be a long chat, so I'll spare you the details. But the green and the blue seems to me the human project for the 21st century. I know it's a big, bold statement. It came before the European Union decided to invest so massively in green technologies and digital technologies. But if you take the green as representative of all our habitats, not just the biological ones, but urban environments, as I showed you before, or social environments, a university, a college like Exeter, a family, your friends and groups, but also the on-life experience, that's also an environment on the one hand, and the blue of all our technologies. Now, today we spoke about artificial intelligence, machine learning, but it could be big data. There's endless talk about tomorrow, quantum computing, maybe, maybe not. Internet of Things, the stuff that we simply carry with us every day. Well, you put these two things together and you can see that that is the marriage that we want. So I started with a divorce, we end up with a marriage. The divorce is between agency and intelligence. Agency has become something that can be engineered successfully to deal with tasks for a purpose at zero intelligence. If I have to do the dishes, I need to exercise some intelligence. My dishwasher does not. That is the future. Remember those two robots, the one that irons the shirts like me, so to speak, and the one that actually builds everything at zero intelligence. This thing plays chess better than anyone in this talk. And of course, it has the intelligence of my grandmother's coffee machine. But that sort of divorce that generated all the story that I've told you. At the end of the story, there is a marriage, and that's the marriage between the green and blue. Now, I stop here, as I've taken enough of your time, with a last remark. This is a novelty. The novelty of putting together technology in the environment. Until recently, any green party would have seen that as a sin, because technology has been interpreted in the analog world as something that, as it develops, destroys the environment. Think about your fridge, your car. Today, digital technology can actually manage to do the opposite, increase our wealth, create more and more for more and more people, while also helping us to deal with the environmental crisis. That is also something that I would like to see more investment, especially from the younger generation, our students. But I stop here. I've taken enough of your time. Thank you for your patience. I promise to be shallow, and I hope I delivered.